Okay, yeah. Welcome back, everybody. If you just came in there for the next talk, they were handed out straws. If you don't have one, there are a couple of here in the front. You might need it during the next talk. It's actually a big honor to announce the next speaker. I've known her for quite some time, but I've never announced her on stage before. She works for Level Level. You can see it on her sweater. She eats, sleeps, and breathes accessibility.
Thank you.
Utrecht is actually her favorite city, and even though she lived here and partied here for quite some time, she never climbed the Dom Tower.
No.
Are you going to do this weekend?
It's out of principle.
Is it too high up?
No, it's just a waste of time. I know what the city looks like from there. It's
okay. Okay, that's good. So give her a very warm round of applause for Rian Rietveld.
Thank you. So, accessibility testing, tools and workflow. You made a website and you want to know what I am doing. Am I doing it the right way? Is what my work will end up accessible? How do I test that? So, that's what my talk is about. First a bit about myself. My name is Rian Rietveld, not Ryan Rietveld. I'm a senior accessibility consultant at Level Level, and there I review all the work, I train the people, and I try to make Level Level a really good accessible agency. Therefore, we started training, so I'm a teacher at the Level Level Academy. There I teach for everybody who wants to learn how to build accessible. All the information on this talk will be online, so you don't have to make notes, you can just sit down and relax at lvl.li/WC030. So all the information is there at the moment online. Also, there's a link to the slides. Good, let's start. What is web accessibility? Laura Kolbach gave an explanation of that. Web accessibility is the degree to which a website is usable by as many people as possible. So it's not just that one blind guy that visits your website. You want to include everyone. And I want to add something to that. On as many devices as possible. Because we are in the age that not everybody looks at a website from desktop. Their tablets, their mobiles, speech interface. Maybe you interact with a website in your car by shouting at it. That's also accessibility. So how do you measure that? Well, there are guidelines. The W3C, that's the World Web Consortium, made guidelines. And they are called WCAG, Web Content Accessibility Guidelines. At the moment we are at version 2.1, and you have three versions. One, A is basic accessibility, double A is the global standard, and triple A is for dedicated software. So we stick to WCAG 2.1AA. Also, the WordPress core must comply with WCAG 2AA. So it's a global standard, and in many countries it's also the law for example, government websites. So there's one standard. So, how and when are you going to test? There are five critical points when to test. First, brand guidelines. If you have a client, and the client is a big company, they probably have brand guidelines. Then you have to examine, before you start, if you can use the colors, the fonts, the images for your website. If, for example, they have a kind of green they want to use in the website, and that green doesn't have good contrast, you cannot use that green for text. So, brand guidelines. Talk to your client. Okay, these are your guidelines, but I cannot take this green for text. Maybe we have to use another green, or maybe not the color at all. This is important. Because if you have to check it at the end and if the green doesn't comply, you have to go to the client, back to the client and to the design team to fix it all over. Second one, third-party plugins. And this will have a huge effect on your quotation, on the amount of hours you spend on a website. For example, you need a checkout form. And the plugin you want to use for that isn't accessible. You cannot use the plugin. What you can do is write it yourself, or hire someone to write it, or convince the plugin author to fix it. The last option is probably not the right one. But you have to consider, but this will have a huge impact on your budget. So select your plugins carefully. Then, web design. Well, I'm going to address that later in full, what you have to test for. But you have to finish the audit of your and the accessibility of your design before you start to code. And when you start to code, every component you test has to be accessible. You have to test everything. And you can only build on another component if the component you finish is accessible. And then the last one is content. If your site is finished and the client or maybe some content creator is adding the content, that also needs to be tested. And very, very important, not at the end. Because if you have to fix something in the beginning, maybe you have to refactor your whole code. And that will maybe twice as much work as if you've done it right and tested it right from the beginning. So this is very important. Not at the end. So, let's start with design. How do you test your design? I have four items to address. Color contrast, the meaning of color, the order of things, and proximity of controls. I will go through them one by one. Color contrast. Not everybody has great eyes. If you get older, you get problems with color contrast. There is a big conspiracy going on that the letters on manuals get smaller and smaller. So color contrast is really important for people to read your site because you want to tell them something, and if they can't read it, well, then that's not good. And maybe you have to convince your graphic designer that very pretty gray on white. Maybe that's not good enough contrast for everybody to see. It may be pretty, but it isn't usable. So find another way. Challenge your designer. So how do you measure the contrast? Well, brace yourself. Color contrast ratio between text and background must be 4.5 or more for normal text, or 3.1 or more for text of at least 24 pixels or 90 pixels bold. You can memorize all that? What? Okay, there are a ton of tools available how to test your design for color contrast. If you Google that, you get 50, 40, I don't know, a lot. I want to show them a few. This one I really like because it's visual very attractive. You add the hexadecimal color or the value for the background and for the text, and it calculates or it validates for WCAG. In this case, the color contrast isn't good enough, so it says it fails for WCAG 2.0. So okay, well that I cannot use. You add other values, and this is actually right. This contrast is right. So the value it says passes AA, level AA, so that's enough. So that's a nice visual way. You can also do it in the browser. Color Alley is an add-on for Chrome. You can install it, and it adds a tab to your inspector. Here, can you see that? Yeah, here. And it actually, you can make a color picker, you can choose the colors from your design. you can add them manually, and it says, does it pass or fail for WCAG? Browsers have developers tools, and they're getting more and more good in also adding accessibility checks. In Sketch, you have add-ons to check the color contrast while you're designing in Sketch. This is in Chrome. This is if you select a color, and it tells you if it fails against the background, and it actually gives a line, and if you stay below the line, it passes for WCAG. So this is built in into Chrome. So no excuse anymore for bad color contrast. Next one, not by color alone. What do I mean with that? Don't give meaning to color. What do I mean with that? Okay, spot the link. I'm gonna make you an offer you can't refuse. Who cannot see the link? Okay, then you're probably colorblind. Okay. People who the most common form of color blindness is if you cannot distinguish red from green from black. So if you have a nice red link in your text or a nice green link in your text and you do not underline it, people miss maybe your call to action. Why don't you just make it underlined? That's the convention. Everybody knows a link in the text is underlined. That's a link. Makes it far more easier for everybody to skim the website and to say, oh, that's a link. So it's more usable, and people who are colorblind also can see it. You don't have to do it in menus and other links. It just links inside the text, that it's different from the text around. Underline it. This is another example. This is a graph. And there you see the stats of different kinds of browsers, how much they are used. And all the icons for the graph are circles, but they're only distinguished by color. So, if you're colorblind, you cannot see the lines, so why don't you make the icons differently? So, if someone is colorblind, can actually also read the graph. This is a good test. Put your design in grayscale. Can I still distinguish everything? Can I still understand everything? So that is a test. You have also a tool called Sim Daltonism, and it's an app for the Mac. And what it does, it adds an overlay over your screen, and it shows how the colors are for someone with color blindness. So in this case, the parrot is red, has red in it, and someone who's colorblind cannot see the red. So it's a nice check to see how does my design look for someone who's colorblind. Okay, next one, the order of things. When you log in the train on the Wi-Fi in the Netherlands, you see free internet in the train. It's a pop-up, a screen. And there's a big button, connect to the Wi-Fi. And if you press that, you get an error message. Because below, there's a checkbox with you have to agree with the terms. So this is what I mean with the order of things. People read from top to bottom. Look at your design, look at this, how your site is structured. People read from top to bottom. And if you have a call to action, and below that there's something they need to fill out too, people miss that. It's confusing. People who get the website read out loud, they don't have an overview over the whole site. So they see the button and they don't know why it doesn't work, because they say, okay, now I have to connect with the Wi-Fi, and below that, then it's announced that they have to agree to the terms. So that actually has to be switched, the order of things. So imagine top to bottom, is everything in the right order? That's a manual check. Last thing, proximity of controls. Keep together what belongs together. If you have a training of an education as a designer, you know that as Gestalt design. And there are the straws. Everybody got a straw? Okay, imagine you don't have an overview over the whole site. And you have an eye disease that your site is getting smaller and smaller and smaller. Some people even see as much as just through a straw. When is this important? For example, I have the media, I want to add a feature image. And then, where is the submit button to edit? It's below here. See? If you have an image and the submit button is on the bottom right. If you only have look through a straw, people scan the page. They have an action, okay, I select the image and they scan the page until they find the submit button. Now, this is a familiar site for us. Here is the insert to button, here's the action, and here's the inserting to post. So this is quite a task for those people. So put together what belongs together. If you have an action and an action below after that, put them together. I'm not a designer. I have no solution for this. Maybe if you want to try and see if you have another way to do this. But this is really not usable. This is not Gestalt design. This is really bad practice. And I don't have an answer. So, that's for the design principles. And I want to switch to development. One big thing I want you all to remember by heart. Test during development and not at the end. Yeah? Everybody knows that? Any Gutenberg developers here? Okay. Oh, how should you test? If you don't test, and if you want to pick any of these tests, pick the top one, keyboard test. Check if it works with keyboard only. Everybody has a keyboard. So, check if it works with keyboard only. That's not really rocket science, actually. I have a small workshop, leonrietveld.com/keyboard. You can use the tab key to go from focusable element to focusable element, like links, submit buttons, input fields, radio buttons. You tap, 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 you can go through the website. A link you can activate with return. A button you can activate with return or with spacebar. You can select, for example, radio buttons with the arrow keys and then press space to select them. It's really not hard. But everything you build must work with keyboard only. And that's not only because some screen reader user or someone who cannot use a mouse uses that, but all the devices that interact with your website depend on good HTML, on good keyboard accessibility. A div and a span don't get keyboard focus. Use a button, for example, if you want to have an action. And if that's kind of mistakes you get out if you keyboard test yourself. This is a skill I think you need to have as a front-end developer. Invest time in this. Because later, if you are talking to our website in the car, it also depends on that mechanism, on every element doing what it's supposed to do. You make more sustainable websites if you actually check for keyboard accessibility. So, that's the first check. The second one, validate if your code has errors. Well, it can easily be done at validated.w3.org. There's an online validator. I will show you later some other tool who does that. There shouldn't be any HTML errors in your code. It should be error-free. It amazes me how little people actually check if their code is error-free. It's okay, it works for me, so it works for everyone. No, you should provide decent error-free code. Or check if there's errors. For example, if you run a website through the validator, you get a report like image element must have alt attribute. This is just a semantic error. And here is an error about not setting up your sizes for your images right. Check that. Does your code validate? Last one. X. X is a tool built by DQ, and I'm really a fan of that. It's built by people who also work together with the people who develop the WCAG standards, so they really know their stuff. And they made a validator for your website you can use online. They have a browser extension. I will show you later how that works. They have an NPM module, and they have a command line interface. So you can also add that to your grunt or gulp routine for automated testing. I will show you how X works in the browser. It's an add-on for Chrome and Firefox. It's X accessibility tester, I think you have to search for for the add-ons. And what it does, it also adds a tab in your inspector. So X, and then it gives a screen with a big blue button, analyze. And if you press analyze, it gives you a report of all the accessibility issues they find in your site. It just goes up in your page, it goes per page, you have to check per page. For example, here, this button must have distinguishable text. Here, that is an error, and actually this is a search button. That's only an icon, and there's no text in it. So someone who's blind doesn't know what the submit button does. There are color contrast issues, so X also checks for color contrast, if your designer didn't do that already. And images must have alternative text. So this is a really good checker. And it gives you very good information. You also can directly jump to inspect node or to highlight, then it highlights where the code occurs. And you have a learn more. So if you click that, you get a complete explanation why this error is an error. Put it in your work routine. Test with keyboard, test with X. X also gets a lot of HTML errors out. So this is a good one to, if you test in your browser, to add it to your work routine. Okay, last one is dynamic content. If you have a page and you want to search, and you have to search without a page, you get a results without a page reload. Or maybe you have a form that does a calculation, and the calculation does it in JavaScript, and it's without a page reload presented on the page. If you can see, you can see what's happening. Oh, there are search results coming. But if you cannot see, it has to be announced to you. And that is done with ARIA. I will not go into specifics on how to do that. I will give a training about that, I hope, recently. But you have to listen with a screen reader if it's actually announced. So, there's a simple way to test your website with a screen reader. Apple VoiceOver with Safari and Narrator with Edge. Some screen readers are really full-featured and they cost a lot of money. But those two, Apple VoiceOver, is built in your Apple, in your Mac. If you use it together with Safari, it has a small a manual that's built in also. Spend one afternoon just trying to figure out how it works and how someone who is blind listens to your website. Narrator with Edge, that's new. Use the good browser with the good, that's also, use the good browser together with a good screen reader. So Narrator together with Edge, and Narrator is just new. And it's also a simple screen reader. You don't have much features, but it gives you a good overview of how people actually hear your website. So, recap for development. Check the generated DOM in the expector. Keyboard test, validate and run X, and check dynamic content with a screen reader. Okay. Last item is content. Who's a content creator? Who writes for the web? Nobody? Come on, we all do. Yeah. Okay, there are three items you need to take care of: reading level, having structure, and meaningful linked text. Reading level, 12 years old. Bah, my audience is way smarter than that. Really. Then you assume that your reader is in fit condition, had a coffee, is awake, in their office, and no distraction. That's the optimal condition. But that's not the case. If you are a parent, or if you have cats, or maybe you have a hangover, this is really recognizable. Maybe you had a fight with your spouse. Maybe your boss is nagging. Maybe you're in a train and there's a lot of distraction. Nobody ever complained that your text was too easy to read. Look at your text. 12 years old is really for everybody good to read. Take some effort in that. And you can actually test that. How do you test that? We are very fortunate to have Yoast SEO, because Yoast SEO has a readability check. And get all the green dots. What's wrong with the green dots? Thankfully, they have text added to it to actually describe if it's good or bad. Okay. So, check your site, if it's actually readable. Next one, heading structure. What's that? This is an old tweet of mine. Dear content managers, headings are not to make text big, but to describe the content that follows. Can you please all remember this? Headings is not to make text big, but to describe the content that follows. So, people who are blind can, for example, navigate by headings. And they think, okay, this is an interesting heading, I can read from there about what's coming. If it's just a big, big heading to a call to action and nothing is following below, that heading is in fact not a heading. But you can make it up with CSS. You don't have to use a heading for that. Headings are the backbone of your content. So use one H1 per page, and that H1 is describing what the page is about. If you think every section needs an H1, come see me afterwards, because that's not longer the case anymore. One H1 per page. The other headings, meaningful, and don't skip a heading level. There are tools to test that. This is a browser extension for Chrome called Headings Map, and it shows you exactly how the headings are. And it also labels in red where it's wrong. So this is a nice tool. This is Gutenberg. In Gutenberg there's an icon with an I in it. I don't know what that means, information. And then it gives you a summary of your site, the content. And there's a document outline, the title, that's the H1. And H2, H3, H2, oops, there's an H4, I'm skipping a level. It gives it a different color and a text in current heading level. So that's built in into Gutenberg. So, heading level, next one, meaningful link text. This was used to be the case in WP Tavern. There's a podcast, and this way to subscribe to the podcast. Subscribe to WP Weekly via iTunes. Click here to subscribe. Subscribe to WP Weekly via RSS. Click here to subscribe. This is really a very bad link text. Because if you can see, you have to, you skim for links, and then you see the link, and then you have to read the whole sentence to actually understand what the link is about. So it kind of takes you extra effort to understand what's going on. So, this is how someone who is blind get the website read out loud. They can call a list of links. And there's a link. Click here to subscribe. Click here to subscribe. Click here to subscribe. I don't know what to subscribe to or what. So then, this is very, very time consuming for people who want to navigate your website with a screen reader. So, I changed it. Subscribe to WordPress Weekly via RSS, via iTunes. So now, these are meaningful links, links that stand out on their own. So, this is the link list, WordPress Weekly via iTunes. So this is a meaningful link. Look at Content Manager at the links. Are they standing out on their own? Are they meaningful? Avoid click here, download, subscribe, learn more. Those are meaningless links in the link list. Having good link text is also very good for your SEO. I hope. Yeah. Okay. Recap. There are 5 critical points. Brand guidelines, third-party plugins, web design, development, and content. And don't test at the end. Okay, everything you want to know is on lvl.li-wco30. And one more thing. I recently joined Level, and there I'm going to give trainings. So if you want to know more about accessibility, about good coding practice, we give one-day workshops for content managers, for designers. We have one workshop for everyone to give a broad overview of everything that's important for if you start an accessible project, and we call it the Level Academy. So, when you get your goodie bag, we added some of our accessibility cards. These are cards with tips for designers, content managers, about how what to look out for if you want to build accessible. And we have also a giveaway. We give away one free workshop. So, it's in your goodie bag. If it isn't in your goodie bag, come and see me and we'll give you one. You can fill out a small form with your name and email address, and you can head it out by the masseur from Level. There's a jar you can put stuff in, and we will give one away in the evening at a bottle. What's a drink? I don't know what's in English. So if you want to, and for everyone attending, we gave 50% off if you're attending here at the WordCamp for a workshop. So, that's it.
Thank you, Rian. Are there any questions, Rian?
What's your opinion about adding accessibility controls like increasing font size and color contrast on your website?
That's bullshit. They have their own equipment for that.
Yeah.
They have their own screen readers, Zoom equipment. They can change the contrast or the black white inverse the colors. They all have their own equipment. You have to make sure that your code is error free and semantic, and then it works. All those equipment works, and all those I call it Ali Pizza. All those buttons, like font size things, it's only to show off, to say, okay, yeah, look, I did done something for accessibility, but people who use that have their own equipment. So don't, you know, just build decently. Good, valid, decent HTML5. Yeah. Yeah.
What do you think about implementing a read speaker and like block readers so they can read?
Yeah. Read speaker, ReadSpeaker is not a screen reader, because with screen reader you can navigate and you can really use the website. A ReadSpeaker reads out the text, and that's convenient for people who are dyslexic or people who are seeing too good for a screen reader and not good enough to actually read a large amount of texts. So those people just press the ReadSpeaker. It's an additional service. Yeah.
How can you test for voice interactivity, like in your car?
Well, speak to it and see what happens.
Yeah, but is there a tool to test something like that on a desktop or a Mac?
I think if the keyboard accessibility works, then that works too, but I haven't really deep into it, so I don't know the exact answer, but also the same, good HTML, then it should work, probably.
Right.
Yeah. Well, yeah, sorry. Dave.
A lot of page builders also Gutenberg includes a lot of divs to a block. If you insert the image, also a lot of divs come into the code. Is that a problem for accessibility? Or if you, for example, put in an image, is it better to put that image into a plastic block around text?
The question is, are page builders who add a lot of divs to the code, is that a problem for accessibility? It's not. Because it adds to the clutter of your code, but it's not a problem for accessibility because div has no meaning at all. What you have to look out for is, if you use a div, is it really something that has no meaning? If it has meaning, you have to give it the semantic element that suits for the image, for the meaning. Like a paragraph is a P, a button for an action, A for an anchor. But don't add all the divs, don't give meaning to all the divs. Don't give add interactions to div. Do that to the actual elements that are there for. But if you have to add a lot of divs for layout, well, eat your heart out, that's okay. It's just, is that your answer to your question? Yeah, okay.
That's one. How do you can convince the client of being accessible? Like, is it okay to see the DevTools audit by saying, you're accessible up for like 90 score?
There are two questions. How do you convince your client for accessibility, or how do you say, this is how well I've done? All the accessibility tools like X don't get everything out. So it's not like, look, I have 90%, so I'm completely accessible. That's not true. With all the tools you use, it's a combination of everything you have to use. There's not like a score, like a number you get somewhere. Because all the tools like X don't get everything out, because that's too hard to do at the moment. Describe what you did. Like, we checked for color contrast, we checked for this, and you give a list of things you actually checked for, I think. I think that's better than just having a big score. Yeah.
I think we have time for one last question. And if not, we're gonna thank Rian really for telling us about accessibility, about the importance of it. So one more round of applause.
Thank you.